Hello, osteology friends. It is Dr. Alsop again to talk a little bit more about the osteology associated with our cranial cavity and brain session. Now, we are going to focus on the cranial fossae, and specifically, we're going to be able to identify these different fossae and then specific structures within these regions. And there are a lot, of foramina, so we're going to talk about how to identify them, as well as why we want you to know them, so what's traversing them. So let's get started. So before I get started, let's talk about the view. And we are looking at a superior view of the basocranium. So the brain would have been sitting right in here. And that is going to show kind of this stair-step fashion of the fossae. So this is a little bit higher when we're talking about the more anterior portions. The middle cranial fossa will be intermediate, and then you'll have this really deep posterior cranial fossa, which makes sense because the cerebellum would be sitting in this region during life. So you're going to have a much deeper or your lowest step associated with the posterior cranial fossa. All right, so let me take a minute really quickly to kind of draw a few lines to help us get an idea of these boundaries. And then we'll talk about each one. Okay, so the anterior cranial fossa will be between the front or the anterior portions of the frontal bone back to the lesser wings of the sphenoid. And so these right here are the lesser wings of the sphenoid. These are going to be, as the name would suggest, lesser, are smaller than these larger, greater wings of the sphenoid. That's kind of making that butterfly shape right there. So, the anterior cranial fossa is between the front of the frontal bone as well as the lesser wings. The middle cranial fossa will go from the lesser wings of the sphenoid to the apex or the top portion of the petrous parts or the petrous parts of the temporal bone. You'll hear it either way. So this kind of top portion of the petrous part of the temporal bone. And then the posterior cranial fossa will be between that apex of the petrous part to the back or the squamous portion of the occipital bone. So here again is the anterior cranial fossa. This will be the middle cranial fossa. And this will be your posterior cranial fossa, which is your deepest of the fossae. All right, so let's talk about the structures within the anterior cranial fossa first. So recall again, I always kind of think of those boundaries. So here is that lesser wing of the sphenoid to the frontal bone, and now we are in the anterior cranial fossa. Now I am outlining what we can see of the ethmoid bone in this particular view. So we'll see the ethmoid bone in numerous other regions. You'll see a portion of it within the orbit. You'll see portions of it playing a role in the nasal septum. But what I've just outlined here is the ethmoid bone. And it's a fairly distinctive looking area. You have this projection right here, which is referred to as the crista galli. The crista galli is going to be the anterior attachment for the fossa cerebri, which is one of your dural partitions. In fact, it's your largest dural partition. But very distinctive, next to, on either side of the crista galli, are all these small holes or foramina. Specifically, we refer to these as the cribriform foramina. And this is how those olfactory nerve axons are heading back towards the brain region. So olfactory nerve is your cranial nerve 1. So this is how those axons are traversing through the region. So very distinctive-like, it's very sieve-like in terms of all these small foramina on either side of the crista galli. Okay. Back towards this region, so we're into the sphenoid bone now. I will once again identify your lesser wings here. And then kind of more in the middle region here, you can see where we're starting to get some dark area right here, indicating that we're heading into a space. Specifically, we're heading into a canal, which are your optic canals. Your optic canals are going to allow the optic nerve or cranial nerve 2 to enter into the orbit, as well as the ophthalmic arteries, which are also heading towards the orbit. Just a note here that while we have the optic canals categorized as part of the anterior cranial fossa based on what the categorization is in Gray's anatomy, you may see in other literature that the optic canals are often defined as being part of the middle cranial fossa. So don't get too bogged down about that. Just understand and be able to identify where the optic canals are. Okay, moving into the middle cranial fossa. This area is a bit more complex in terms of the foramina associated with this region. So here is your middle cranial fossa. The first thing we're going to identify is the most anterior structure of the middle cranial fossa, and these are your superior orbital fissures, which are going to be located, I always like to think of them as kind of underneath those lesser wings of the sphenoid. So underneath the lesser wings of the sphenoid, sometimes it can be difficult to see them in this superior view. We'll have other views in subsequent videos where you're looking at it through the orbit. It's a little bit easier to see there. Now, the superior orbital fissure, as its name would suggest, is heading towards the orbit, so it allows things to traverse this region into the orbital region. So a lot of the nerves that you need to get into the orbit, like oculomotor, trochlear, abducens, as well as V1, or your first division of the trigeminal nerve, will also traverse the superior orbital fissure, as well as the ophthalmic veins. All right, let's talk about this region right here in the middle. This whole complex right here is referred to as the cella turcica. And you can see the cella turcica means Turkish saddle. You can see that you have kind of this saddle-like region right here. And this divot right here, or this fossa, is referred to as the hypophyseal fossa. And this is where portions of the pituitary gland sit. And so it makes sense that this whole area is fairly complex osteologically because you need to afford a lot of protection to that very important pituitary gland. And so sometimes pituitary gland is referred to as the hypophysis. And so that's why you have the hypophyseal fossa. Sometimes you see this spelled with an E. In fact, oftentimes you'll see it spelled with an E. Gray's Anatomy, I think, just recently updated the Terminologica Anatomica, which is kind of where we get the anatomical names, kind of the end-all be-all, has just transitioned to this type of spelling here. So if you see it with an E, it means the same thing. It doesn't really matter as long as you can identify. Okay, so let's go back to this greater wing region of the sphenoid. Like I said, it forms this nice butterfly shape here. And let's talk about some of the foramina here. So we'll start with this nice circular foramina here. These are the foramen rotundum. So the foramen rotundum is going to allow for V2, or your maxillary nerve, or your second division of the trigeminal nerve, to exit the skull. So those three names that I just said all mean the same thing. So that is what's exiting through the foramen rotundum. The more oval shape foramen here is going to be the foramen ovale. And the foramen ovale is going to allow for V3, or your mandibular nerve, or your third division of the trigeminal nerve, to exit the skull. And V3 is the largest division, and so that's why you have a slightly larger foramen here. And then lateral and really small, you're going to have the foramen spinosum. The foramen spinosum is going to allow the middle meningeal artery to ascend or enter into the skull. So middle meningeal artery, we'll talk a little bit about that later, but it's going to be one of the dominant supplies for the meninges, so it has to get into the skull. So that is how it is entering. Okay, the posterior cranial fossa, as we mentioned, is going to extend from the apex of the petrous part back to the occipital bone. This whole region right here is considered the petrous part. It's a really neat region. You actually have your middle and your inner ear housed within the petrous part of the temporal bone. And this line that I keep drawing is kind of the top or the apex of the petrous part. Now, I kind of, right around this region, and this is difficult to see as well, you're going to have two openings into that petrous part. So entering into the bone here. And these are your internal acoustic meati. Meatus is singular. The IAM is going to allow the facial nerve as well as vestibular cochlear, so cranial nerves 7 and 8, to enter into the petrous part of the temporal bone. Okay, moving along, so there's that jugular foramen that we have talked about over and over again. That's going to be right about here. Your hypoglossal canals are going to be right in this region. We talked about this in one of the other videos as well. Like I mentioned there, I always try to find the foramen magnum and then head towards the basilar part of the occipital, and it'll be kind of hiding out right in there. That will allow cranial nerve 12 or your hypoglossal nerve to exit. Okay, so these are some of the foramina of the cranial fossae and obviously the boundaries associated with them. As you review this material and if any questions come up, always feel free to reach out to me or any of my colleagues. Please have a wonderful rest of your day.